Chapter 7, Estimating Parameters and Determining Sample Size. The first section, 7.1, we will be estimating a population proportion. The key concepts in this section presents methods for using a sample proportion to make an inference about the value of the corresponding population proportion. There are three main concepts included in the section. Point estimate. The sample proportion, P hat, is the best point estimate of the population proportion P. The confidence interval, abbreviated CI. We can use a sample proportion to construct a confidence interval estimate of the true value of a population proportion. Sample size. We should know how to find the sample size necessary to estimate a population proportion. So basically, we're using sample statistics to make an inference about the population. A point estimate is a single value used to estimate a population parameter. The sample proportion, P hat, is the best point estimate of the population proportion P, and here's how we find it. P hat, the sample proportion, the point estimate for the population proportion, is found by taking x and dividing it by n. X is the number of successes, n is the number of sample values. We use p hat as the point estimate of p because it is unbiased and it is the most consistent of the estimators that could be used. An unbiased estimator is a statistic that targets the value of the corresponding population parameter in the sense that the sampling distribution of the statistic has a mean that is equal to the corresponding population parameter. The statistic p hat targets the population proportion p. Here's an example. A Gallup poll was taken in which 1,487 adults were surveyed and 639, or 43% of them, said that they have a Facebook account, a Facebook page. Based on that result, find the best point estimate of the proportion of all adults who have a Facebook page. Because the sample proportion is the best point estimate of the population proportion, we conclude that the best point estimate of P is 0.43. If using the sample results to estimate the percentage of all adults who have a Facebook page, the best point estimate is 43%. Try this example. In a study of the accuracy of fast food drive-through orders, McDonald's had 33 orders that were not accurate among 362 orders observed, based on data from QSR Magazine. Find the best point estimate of the population proportion P, that is the proportion of inaccurate orders for the population. If you refer back to the best point estimate identified for the population proportion P, you would know that that is P hat. P hat is equal to X over N. X is the number of successes. In this particular case, the success is the number of orders that were not accurate. We're looking for the best point estimate of the population proportion P, the proportion of inaccurate orders for the population. So X is 33, N is 362, that was the total number of orders observed. Therefore, P hat is equal to 33 over 362, and doing that quick calculation on a basic calculator, 33 divided by 362 is equal to 0.09116, or approximately 0.0912. If I change that to a percentage, that would be approximately 9%. Best point estimate for the population of population proportion P of the number of inaccurate orders. A confidence interval, or interval estimate, is a range or an interval of values used to estimate the true value of a population parameter. A confidence interval is sometimes abbreviated as CI. So instead of one particular value to estimate the population parameter, we're going to have a range of values to estimate our population parameter. The confidence level is the probability 1 minus alpha, such as 0.95 or 95%, that the confidence interval actually does contain the population parameter, assuming that the estimation process is repeated a large number of times. The confidence level is also called the degree of confidence or the confidence coefficient. Here's a chart showing the relationship between the confidence level and alpha. The confidence level of 95% is the value used most often. So if we have a 90% confidence level, the decimal representation of 0.90, then the corresponding value of alpha would be 0.10, because 0.10 plus 0.90 equals 1. The other values of alpha are found in a similar fashion. To interpret a confidence interval, we have to be very careful to interpret it correctly. For example, there is a correct interpretation and many different and creative incorrect interpretations of this given interval. A proportion of the population is between 0.405 and 0.455. Wrong would be there's a 95% chance that the true value of P will fall between those numbers. Wrong would be 95% of sample proportions fall between those numbers. The correct interpretation of the interval is that we are 95% confident that the interval from 0.405 to 0.455 actually does contain the true value of the population proportion P. The confidence level of 95% tells us that the process we are using should, in the long run, result in confidence interval limits that contain the true population proportion 95% of the time. And here's a graphical representation of a confidence interval from 20 different samples. Critical values. Critical value is the number on the borderline separating sample statistics that are significantly low or significantly high from those that are not significant. The number here, Z sub alpha over 2, is a critical value that is a Z-score with the property that it is the border that separates the area of alpha over 2 in the right tail of the standard normal distribution. Here's a pictorial representation of that particular statement. So the relationship between the area in the tails Z and Z sub alpha over 2. For example, find the critical value Z sub alpha over 2 corresponding to a 95% confidence level. A 95% confidence level corresponds to alpha equals 0.05, so alpha over 2 is 0.025. The figure on the next slide shows that the area in each of the green shaded tails is alpha over 2 equals 0.025. We find that the Z associated with that is 1.96 by noting that the cumulative area to its left must be 1 minus 0.025 or 0.975. We're referring to table A2 to find that the cumulative area of 0.9750 corresponds to that Z number. For 95% confidence level, then, the critical value is 1.96. Here's the pictorial representation. So we've marked Z of alpha over 2, and the Z of alpha over 2 tail area is 0.025. If I subtract that from 1, then this Z number, we're looking for the right-hand Z number, would be the Z associated with 1 minus 0.025, which would be this area to the left, including that tail. And if I look at the chart, I should find that the Z is 1.96. There are some common critical values that we use for Z. And in the previous example, we found that a 95% confidence level results in a critical value of Z of alpha over 2 of 1.96. This is the most common critical value. The other common critical values are listed in the table. With 90% confidence and alpha of 0.10, the critical value is 1.645, and the other 199% as an alpha of 0.01 is 2.575. Example, find the critical value. You'll need your formula and charts packet, and we're going to be referring to the Z tables in the packet to find the critical values associated with the confidence levels. I'll do the first one, and then I would suggest you pause the video, try to find the second one, and then resume the video, and you'll see how I found the second one. For 98% confidence, I first identify alpha. Ninety-eight percent is equal to 0.98. 1 minus alpha is equal to 0.98. Alpha is equal to 0.02. Alpha over 2 is 0.01. Therefore, when I draw the normal curve to I'm looking for the Z associated with this area in the tail, which is 0.01. I look for a positive Z score that's 1 minus 0.01 or 0.9900. Looking at my chart, positive Z score 0.9900, the closest value associated with that is 0.9901, therefore 2.33 is my Z score. So 2.33 is the critical value associated with a 98% confidence level. You try 94%, pause the video, and follow a similar process. For 94%, alpha is 6% or 0.06. Alpha over 2 then is going to be 0.03. When I draw the normal curve, I'm looking for this Z right here. Alpha over 2 is 0.03, which means that the area I'm going to look up in the table is 1 minus 0.03 or 0.9700. And looking that area up, 0.9700, the closest I can get to that is 0.9699, which gives me a 1.88 critical value. So the critical value here is 1.88. Margin of error. When data from a simple random sample are used to estimate a population proportion p, the difference between the sample proportion p hat and the population proportion p is an error. The maximum likely amount of that error is the margin of error denoted by the letter E. There is a probability of 1 minus alpha, such as 0.95, that the difference between p hat and p is E or less. So it's the margin of error. The margin of error E is also called the maximum error of the estimate and can be found by multiplying the critical value, which is why we found the critical value, and the estimated standard deviation of sample proportions. Here's the formula for the margin of error for proportions. E equals Z sub alpha over 2, that's the critical value we just practiced finding, times the square root of p hat times q hat over n. That's going to be the estimated standard deviation of sample proportions. Please note that p hat plus q hat equals 1. Let's practice calculating the margin of error. Find the margin of error based on the following information. We have a 96% confidence level. X is 33 and n is 362. The formula is x is equal to z sub alpha over 2 times the square root of p hat q hat over n. We have p hat is equal to 33 over 362. Q hat would be 1 minus 33 over 362. Let me clean that up a little bit there. And n is equal to 362. Z of alpha over 2 would be 96% confidence. And I don't believe did we find that? Nope, we found 98% and 94%. So 96% confidence would be a alpha, let's see, alpha is equal to 0.04. Alpha over 2 would be equal to 0.02. So if I look up the area, 0.02, this would be 0.9800. I'm looking for the Z. If I look in my chart, 0.9800, looks like this one's the closest, 2.05. So the Z is 2.05. Calculating E then would be 2.05 times the square root of 33 over 362 times 1 minus that number. If you're going to use decimal approximations in here, you need to keep at least 6 places. But I'm not going to do that. I'm going to actually use the original values. So with my TI-83, which you can use the other calculator, we're just doing the number crunching. I'm going to find first the square root of 33 divided by 362 times 1 minus that, 33 divided by 362, and that's divided by 362, and then I'm going to multiply that by 2.05, and I end up with 0.03101. The margin of error is usually rounded, unless we're going to be plugging it into a confidence interval. So if it is, then we need to keep our decimal places that are indicated on the display, which is an approximation, but at least it's a more precise approximation than 3 significant digits. So that's how you find the margin of error.